Одного моего друга, когда-то он лежал в больнице, и его спросили соседи по палате, чем ты занимаешься? Он говорит, квантовая теория поля. Чего, агроном, что ли? Вот на этой славной ноте let us start our second session by Gleb Arutyunov. So please, Gleb.
Okay, so today my goal is to talk about quantum theory, about quantizing fields, and of course it's a very vast subject. I cannot explain all things in detail, so I decided that I will make the discussion of some essential points, some points which might attract your attention, considering three basic fields: a scalar field, electromagnetic field, and the Dirac field. And I will start from the scalar field, which is described by the following action. So S on R is given by 1 over C integral d for x, 1 half d mu phi, d mu phi, minus m c over d bar squared phi squared. So as you have heard yesterday, very often in the literature, almost everywhere, people prefer to work in the natural system of units, where h bar and c is equal to 1. But sometimes it's really important to keep h bar and c explicitly, because it also clarifies a bit on the physical content of the theory you are dealing with. In particular, if you just look at the Klein-Gordon field, you see that in order to make this object, all the terms in this expression, to have the proper dimension, you really need to write the mass term in the form mc divided by h bar squared. So in fact, if you think a little bit, maybe you remember the meaning of this quantity here, h bar divided by mc. Maybe some of you knows what it is. This quantity has a special name. It's a Compton wavelength, indeed. Very good. Compton wavelength. And so, if you would like to introduce a massive Klein-Gordon equation and would like to discuss it, it's inevitable that you introduce also h bar. So h bar is a quantity which is not necessarily associated with the quantum nature of the theory. Even if you would like to write down such a simple action as this one for a massive scalar field, you inevitably have to use h bar. Otherwise, you simply cannot write the last term. And the meaning of this quantity here in reality is 1 over lambda Compton squared. This is what is standing in front of phi squared, if you restore all the units. So this is the first thing to have in mind. And of course, you know very well that if you vary this equation, if you vary this action, you will obtain the Klein-Gordon equation, which is this guy here, phi is equal to 0. And in order to proceed with the quantization, the most convenient way to do this is to develop the Hamiltonian formalism. Actually, Hamiltonian formalism, in particular in quantum field theory, plays an extremely important role. Hamiltonian formalism, because this is a way to approach the so-called canonical quantization approach to classical field theory. So Hamiltonian formalism lies in the heart of canonical quantization scheme. And so it's important to understand how you pass from the Lagrangian description of the system to the Hamiltonian. And as you know from the textbooks, in order to do this, you need to introduce the notion of the canonical momentum. I will denote the canonical momentum by the letter pi. In order, I will not use p here because p will be associated with a four momentum of a particle, so I will use pi and x. And the definition is standard, so what you need to do, you need to vary Lagrangian with respect to velocity of the field. And if you do it in our case, here you will get pi dot divided by c squared. By the way, this extra term 1 over c, again, this is a thing you never see, almost never you see in the books, but this is standing here in order to do the following. So if you write this measure d for x, this is d3x multiplied by dx0. dx0 is a c dt. And this c then cancels with this c here. And so your expression can be written as a three-dimensional integral over x and the integral over time of the local Lagrangian density, which is then written as an integral over time of Lagrangian dependent on time. And Lagrangian dependent on time here is the quantity, which is an integral of the Lagrangian density over three space. And this is 1 over c standing here just to cancel. That c this comes from the measure. Now, if you introduce the canonical momentum in the standard way, and you write the Hamiltonian H, then you obtain the following expression, dx integral c squared pi squared plus bi pi bi pi plus the mass term mc over h bar squared pi squared. This is manifestly positive definite Hamiltonian for the Klein Gordon field. And from this Hamiltonian, you can also read very easily physical dimensions of all quantities of interest. So in particular, Hamiltonian must have the dimension of energy. Let me denote the energy unit by this letter E. On the right-hand side, you have L cubed, so length cubed coming from this integration measure. And then here, for instance, if you want to know the dimension of the field phi, you can concentrate on this term here, which produces for you 1 over L squared coming from derivatives, and then unknown dimension of field phi squared. And from here, you find out that the dimension, physical dimension of the field phi is nothing else as a square root of energy divided by length. And that is important to remember. By the way, physical dimensions, this is something which you associate to physical quantities. These are dimensions of physical quantities. And all equations you write in classical and in quantum field theory does not matter. They always, dimensions on the left should always match the dimensions on the right. And this is an important check. If you have an equation and you restore the dimensions of physical quantities, physical dimensions should always match. And of course, under the quantization procedure, dimensions of physical quantities do not change. As they are in the classical theory, they become, as they are, stay the same in the quantum theory. That's important to remember. Now, energy divided by length, you can also write in this way. You can multiply it by time here. By time, is it what I'm doing here? Yes, you can do it by time, and you can multiply it by another. So you should divide it by time as well. So let's see what is a convenient way to do. Yeah, maybe I will do it later when it comes to the discussion. Let me just mention that energy divided by length actually is the dimension of the force. And also, sometimes people call this thing, which is energy per unit length, they call it tension. Yeah, important for string theory in particular, tension of a string. So tension is the energy per unit length, and you see that in quantum field theory, in four dimensions, the field phi has a dimension of a square root of a tension.
Now you can also look at the dimension of the canonical momentum, and for canonical momentum you will find that its dimension, a similar analysis, will be given by 1 over L square root of energy divided by L. And now you can return back to your action, and since you know the dimension of the field phi, you can check the dimension of the action. So dimension of the action is 1 over C L4, coming from this integration measure, 1 over L squared, coming from these derivatives, and then phi squared. And phi squared is energy divided by L. And so you see that at the end of the day, what you get here is energy multiplied by L divided by C. Yeah. So you multiply this by T, by T. Energy multiplied by T by L. Where here you get L. So this is canceled. And energy multiplied by T has a dimension of Planck, of H power. This is the same as dimension of H power. So from here it follows that action has naturally the dimension of H bar. And H bar has the same dimension as an angular momentum. Energy multiplied by T, you might think about this as, if you wish, as mc squared multiplied by T, or mc multiplied by ct. Ct is length, and mc is the momentum, so momentum by length is angular momentum g. So h bar has a dimension of angular momentum, and this is the same as the dimension of the action. This is some exercise of these units and dimensions. Now, an important object in the Hamiltonian formulation of classical field theory, and then also an important object to proceed with canonical quantization, is the notion of the Poisson bracket. And now, in the context of field theory, what I have to do, I have to define the Poisson bracket, which is defined on a space of functionals depending on my canonical momenta and my fields, phi and x and phi and x. So I deal with functionals of these canonical variables. So canonical variables phi and phi constitute my phase space in the case of field theory, and the Poisson bracket is introduced absolutely in the same way as you do in classical mechanics. Let me just see that I'm not making a mistake with signs. So Poisson bracket on the space of functionals. So I consider f and g to be two functionals, and the Poisson bracket is defined as a following functional, which you put in correspondence to f and g. So this is variational derivative of f with respect to phi on x, variational derivative of g with respect to phi, minus delta g over delta phi on x, delta f over delta phi on x. And you integrate over x. So could you remind me the properties of the Poisson bracket? You should probably know this from classical mechanics.
Anti-symmetry.
Anti-symmetry, yes. Symmetry. G is equal to minus GF.
Jacobi.
Identity.
Identity.
Yes. Jacobi identity. So you have FG and insert function OK. And then you add up the set implementation, and the result must be equal to zero. And also, you can add up to this thing that this operation is bilinear, bilinear, and satisfies also Leibniz rule. Leibniz rule meaning that if you have f multiplied by g with some k, then this gives you bracket of f k multiplied by g plus f g k. Okay, this is this. All these properties can be straightforwardly verified from this definition. This definition satisfies all these brackets. All these properties. So we have a phase space, and on the phase space we define an operation which is called Poisson bracket, which takes two functions in the phase space and put them in correspondence as a function which is called their bracket. And so you can now consider these fields pi and phi as functionals themselves, and if you do a computation of the by the way, that's important to realize also that the computation you are doing here, your functionals here, f and g, are taken at the one and the same moment of time. So time, moment, is the same for both f and g. And so this Poisson bracket, therefore, sometimes it's called equal time. Equal time plus one bracket. And so now if you consider the field phi and the field phi as functional themselves, then you can perform the computation of the bracket according to this rule. And you find out that phi and phi commute at different space points at the same moment of time. They commute with respect to some bracket. The same is with pi's, while the bracket between pi and phi is non-trivial and equals to the delta function x minus 1. And in the Hamiltonian formalism, the Lagrangian equations of motion gets replaced by the Hamiltonian equations. Namely, for any function f, which for any function f on the phase space, which does not explicitly depend on time, its time evolution is described by the following equation: f dot is equal to Poisson bracket of the Hamiltonian with f. So this is evolution equation in the Hamiltonian formalism. Okay. So, one interesting point to have in mind is the following here. That if you have two quantities, two functionals, f and g, which have definite dimension, definite physical dimension, which I denote by f and g. So these are dimensions of the functionals f and g, inherited from pi and phi. Then the Poisson bracket, the dimension of the Poisson bracket of these two functionals, is offset from the product of the dimensions of f and g precisely by one power of h bar. So dimension of the bracket, to compute the dimension of the bracket, you need to multiply dimensions of f and g and divide by h bar.
you can easily prove this statement. How it's proved? You consider the variation delta f. By definition, this is dx delta f over delta phi, delta phi on x. This is the definition of the variation of the functional phi via the variational derivative. So this quantity here is called variational derivative. And now, dimension of delta phi is the same as the dimension of phi. So you have dimension of f is the same as the dimension of delta f. So you replace dimension of delta f by the dimension of f. On the right-hand side here, you have L cube. Dimension of delta phi is the same of the dimension of phi. And the dimension of phi is square root of energy divided by L. Square root of energy divided by L. And then it's multiplied by the dimension of delta f over delta phi. Right? And from here, you read off the dimension of delta f over delta phi. This must be, according to what I'm computing, dimension of f divided by L in the power 5 over 2 energy in the power 1 half. And analogously, if you consider the variation of f with respect to pi, delta f over delta pi, delta pi, then from here you deduce that delta f over delta pi, dimension of this quantity is f multiplied by c, speed of light, L in the power 3 over 2, energy 1 half. That follows from the fact that dimension of pi is the same as dimension of delta pi, and this is, as we discussed, given by this expression. Now you just take this definition here and compute the dimension. So dimension of the bracket FG is the product of these dimensions and multiply by L cube, because you integrate the integration measure, so it's L cube. So L cube multiply by these dimensions. So F, dimension of F, dimension of G, L in the power 5 over 2, energy 1 half. So this is dimension of F, dimension of G coming, dimension of delta G over delta pi will be now C L 3 over 2, 1 half. Very simple calculation. Which gives you C over L, F, G, energy. And this is the same as F, G, product, energy multiplied by T, which is F, G divided by H. So it gives you an idea that when you replace upon quantization the Poisson bracket by the commutator, and you put in front of the delta function in the right hand side h bar, so what is happening, you simply restore the right dimension in the quantum field theory. Which is a very simple explanation why h bar should be on the right hand side. It's very, trivial as that.
It's very funny for me. Many years back, when people invented quantum field theory, they wanted to read off from. They understood all dimensions. But
that's right.
We all forget about this, but you restore the knowledge
yes.
back.
I am very in a very simple line of the action.
Yes.
Okay. Perfect. Yeah. It looks very nice.
Good. Good. Now, so what we do upon quantization? The standard canonical quantization prescription tells us that now, when we go to the quantum theory, what we have to do? We have to replace observables, on classical observables on the phase space, by operators acting in some Hilbert space. And this map from classical observables to operators in the Hilbert space must satisfy certain requirements, of course. And upon this replacement of classical observable by the corresponding operator in the Hilbert space, so I will write this map as simply F classical goes to operator, quantization map. This important object is called Poisson bracket in the classical theory. Goes to an object which is called quantum Poisson bracket. And the quantum bracket for the case of this basic field forming the coordinatization of the phase space, the bracket is defined as I divided by H bar commutator. So commutator is an operation which is well-defined for operators in the Hilbert space. So you take the operators and you commute them, AB minus BA. And quantum bracket is an operation which satisfies precisely the same properties as a classical Poisson bracket. So quantum bracket is required, it's one of the requirements of Dirac, that quantum bracket satisfies all the properties of the classical bracket. So in other words, quantum mechanics is simply a different realizations of the same set of axioms. So if you put in your axiomatic description a postulate about the existence of the Poisson bracket satisfying this set of rules, then you just find for it another realization on the space of, as you know, Hermitian operators acting in the Hilbert space. And this set of operators is realized by means of commutator. In fact, there is an extremely simple argument which belongs to Dirac that if you assume that now your classical observables, which are functions on the phase space, are replaced by operators or by some non-commutative objects, then there is no way you can define your quantum bracket differently from the commutator. It's a unique way to do that. I'm not sure that this is a well-known argument, but I'm going to reproduce it on the blackboard. It's very simple. So suppose you define an object which is called quantum bracket, and you want to define it on a space of non-commutative variables. But you want this object to satisfy absolutely the same set of rules which you have for the normal Poisson bracket. Then what you do? You take four relatively arbitrary, just arbitrary, elements from your non-commuting algebra. Let's call them A, B, C, D. And you form the unknown quantum bracket between the product A, B and C, D. Let me not write quantum bracket. It's all the time I'm talking here on this blackboard will be the quantum bracket QB. So I write it only once and then I will write it. And then according to that rules, in particular to the Leibniz rule, you can perform the computation of this object. And you can do it in two different ways. The way number one is the following. So I can compute it like this. So I can write it as a bracket of A with CD multiplied by B plus A B CD. This is a step number one. I'm applying the Leibniz rule, but I'm not allowed to change the order of these letters because they are non-commuting. And then I continue with the computation. So this is AC DB plus C AD B. Plus here, I compute this one, gives me A B C D plus A C B D. So this is the root number one. Now the root number two.
So something is wrong.
Something wrong
in the second bracket.
In the second bracket, B, C.
D. No, no, no.
Ah, this one.
Here,
okay.
Here,
would
B's.
Be A.
Yeah,
thank you.
Here,
A,
uh-huh.
B.
Yeah. Yes, yes.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And now root number one, root number two, A, B, C, D. Quantum bracket is computed differently. Now I'm first keeping AB together, and I write it as AB, comma C, AB, comma C, D plus C, AB, comma D. And now I open this up again. A comma C B D plus A B comma C D plus C A D B plus C B A D. Yeah, so there is a mistake. Sorry. This is wrong. So here C A D B goes to the right, and here I have A was with D, and now C A B comma D. And now you compare. So these two must agree because I start from the one and the same expression. The starting expression is the same. And I compare. So the right hand sides also should coincide. And you see that this term here is equal to this one. While this term is equal to this one. And the rest should agree as well. But what is the rest? Now, I subtract, say, from this, from the second, I subtract the first, and I get the following equality. A comma C multiplied by BD minus DB must be equal to AC minus CA B comma D. And now I restore QB to stress that this is our unknown bracket. And this is what you get. And now, if your
quantum observables A, B, C, D are arbitrary, unrelated objects, a priori unrelated objects. To satisfy this equality, there is only one way. You have to conclude that AC is proportional, quantum bracket is proportional to the commutator with some constant. And the same is with BD. BD is proportional to, which is a consistent assumption for all A, B, C, D in order to satisfy this relation. So, very naturally, you come to the realization of this quantum bracket of A, B as something which must be proportional to the commutator, A, B minus B, A. If you, of course, want to preserve these properties, the classical Poisson bracket. For anti-commuting variables, you should be a bit careful because if you would be quantizing fermions, then you will repeat all this discussion. But then, of course, naturally, you have to remember about the gradients, how you put things to the left and to the right, and then you will come to the conclusion there should be commutator instead, anti-commutator instead of now,
what conditions we should have on these four operators? Shouldn't they be full set observables or something like that?
For this argument, it does not really matter.
Okay. Thank you.
Full set observables is a bit dangerous because if you want to observe them, they must commute with each other. So you don't obtain much. Okay? Good. That was some side remark. Now, you are familiar with the term second quantization, or should I explain this? Or you know this? More or less, you understand. So, what we do, we come to the creation annihilation operators, which is essentially a quantization procedure telling us how to separate positive and negative energy solutions, to put them in correspondence to positive waves and negative waves, relate to them operators of creation and annihilation, pick up the vacuum state, and build up states in the so-called Fock space. And this would be realization of quantum field theory in the Fock space. And so the Hamiltonian, at the end of the day, constructed in terms of creation and annihilation operators, will take such a simple form. It's VK, where omega on K is a frequency, which is K bar of K dagger plus, let me write it in natural units, it would be just M squared. In not natural units, K will be a wave vector and M will be replaced by a M C over H bar, which is an inverse quantum wave. And from this expression, you see that the free Klein-Gordon field is nothing else as a collection, infinite collection of the harmonic oscillators. Each oscillator is numerated by the frequency vector. One thing about Klein-Gordon equation, maybe I will give some historical remark. So, in fact, Klein-Gordon equation was discovered before Klein and Gordon and everyone else by Schrödinger himself. And what's the idea? The idea was to construct relativistic quantum mechanics, namely quantum mechanics which would be compatible with the relativistic dispersion relation, p squared minus energy squared minus momentum squared is equal to m squared, relativistic dispersion relation. And the idea of Schrödinger was extremely simple, is to replace
to replace E by the operator E h bar d over dt, to replace P by the operator minus I h bar gradient, putting everything in here, and then we get 1 over C squared E over dt squared minus gradient d2 over dx I squared minus plus m squared c squared over h bar squared, acting on pi, and act with this operator on the wave function. Now this would be an analog of the Schrödinger equation for the case of a relativistic particle. So we do absolutely the same in non-relativistic quantum mechanics. So energy is replaced by this operator, this is a momentum, and then we have some non-relativistic Hamiltonian in which we replace P by such an operator, and we act with the result, you know, the Schrödinger equation h bar, u psi over dt minus h psi, and that is equal to u psi would be, let's write it this way, let's write it as a h psi, where h will be our quantum Hamiltonian depending on this operator P. And then if we put everything to the one side, we can treat it as an operator I h bar d over dt minus h as a function of p, acting on the wave function psi is equal to zero. And so the idea was to mimic precisely the same situation, but now for the case of a relativistic particle, and you know that if you go to the Fourier representation for the field phi, then in the Fourier space, you will immediately reproduce this standard dispersion relation. And so everything seems to be fine. So the question is, why it's not good to treat phi as a wave function? Why not to call it wave function? So classical Klein-Gordon equation, as we start with it, maybe we should treat it actually as an equation, as a quantum mechanical equation for some wave function. And this would be a mechanical equation describing for us the quantum mechanics of a relativistic particle. So the question is, what is bad? What is wrong with this? Why we need quantum field theory? Why it's not enough? So the point sits here. It's not enough just to write this equation and talk about the wave function. You have to give the wave function probabilistic interpretation. And here you have a trouble. Because, you know that the wave function is naturally a complex valued function. So in order to discuss it in the context of the, in order to have it complex valued, you have to change a little bit your setting and start from the complex Klein-Gordon field, which is not a much difference in comparison to what you told you already, what I told you already. You just need to consider complex phi. And then equation describing this field is phi phi is equal to this. And then you repeat your procedure, and for phi and phi star, you will get the Klein-Gordon equation I already written. But the point is that now you can introduce the quantities which you would like to treat in analogy with a non-relativistic quantum mechanics as a probability density and probability current. So that would be probability density and probability current. And probability density, if I put all dimensions, physical dimensions right, must be the following expression. Dt phi minus phi dt phi star, like this. And the probabilistic current is 2m phi star gradient of phi minus phi gradient of phi star. And you can check that this is good definition in a sense that the continuity equation is satisfied as a consequence of a Klein-Gordon equation.
So it's this is the divergence of the current here. So okay, let's write it like this: divergence of J, 0 over dt plus divergence of J is equal to 0. So continuity equation is a consequence of Klein-Gordon. So that looks nice. And what else? Yes, in the non-relativistic limit, you can show that the probability density goes to a non-relativistic expression where rho is phi star phi, or modulus phi squared. And so you seem to be happy about it, because your probabilistic interpretation seems to work. But unfortunately, this is not the case, because probability density now is not generically positive definite. It can take also negative values. Because your field phi satisfies the second order differential equation. And it's different from usual classical, from the usual quantum mechanics, second order differential equation in time. And that means that in order to solve this equation, you can specify field and its time derivative, you can associate to them arbitrary values. So a priori, this object rho here can be also, can take negative values, and then your probabilistic interpretation becomes, goes away, can be negative. And so probably for the case of the free field, this is not so big problem. You can start from the initial conditions for a state with a positive probability density. And then under the time development, this will be preserved. Positivity will be preserved. But unfortunately, as soon as you turn on interactions, then this definition will not survive. Under the time development, this might become negative and so on. So, that is the main problem here, and it was known for a long time, and it was not clear how to overcome it. And actually, with the discovery, and for the Dirac, it was a starting point how to overcome negative probability problem of Klein-Gordon equation when he was trying to construct the quantum mechanics of electron. That was a starting point.
Klein paradoxes.
Yeah, Klein paradox, yes. There are various kinds of paradoxes which you immediately encounter when you try to treat field phi is a quantum mechanical field. So this is not the case. So now we know that what we do, we have to quantize our field. So we substitute it for an operator. It gives rise us creation annihilation operator, so from which we can build up one particle states and then multi-particle states. And so this way of realizing quantization of a scalar field, I think it was for the first time understood by Pauli and Weisskopf. How to do it properly, how to treat this quantization of the scalar field properly. And in a way, this passage from a classical field to operator is called second quantization. This term has been coined by Dirac. So second quantization. This word is due to Dirac. But in fact, Schweber in his book is writing that this the whole procedure of second quantization, somehow he attributes it to Jordan. I'm not sure I can comment on this, but this is what he writes in his book. In any case, this term was put by Dirac, and why it's second? Because first you start from the classical field phi, then you think about this first Klein-Gordon equation as an equation for phi being like a wave function, and this is called the first quantization, and then you take your wave function and you promote it to operator the second time. It's like you quantize the second time. And that's why this term is second quantization. But in fact, I don't think it has a lot of meaning here. It's just a historical way, historical development, which is associated with this discussion. From classical, like classical, to Klein-Gordon, it's like a wave function, which is not, in fact, as we know, and then operator. Operator and Fock space. Operator, Fock space. Okay, any questions here? I think this all the remarks I wanted to give you about free Klein-Gordon field. And then I will go to the next one.
I have a remark.
Yeah.
Sure. Maybe two. Mm-hmm. First of all, your Klein-Gordon equation is not consistent with the dispersion relation you have written. You have insisted that we should keep C, the speed of light, in the equation, but the upper equation for
upper equation we can write
is inconsistent with
MC squared.
E over C squared. Yes.
Sure.
And I think that it
that
would
was
be
the natural use.
Yes. And I think it would be very useful to write explicitly the expansion of the field phi in terms of equation annihilation operators. We know that there are different normalizations. And in this case, you have different commutation relations for these operators. So it would be fine if you would show explicitly what normalization you are using.
Yeah.
That's just one point that...
I can do this, no problem. Let me show you some formulas. Why not? Let's do some...
Because in literature there are many different notations.
Yes.
All of them are right. Okay.
Yes, they are
all
okay.
Of them are consistent.
They give the same Hamiltonian, but on the way you can normalize them differently. There is relativistic invariant normalization. There are non-invariant, but finally you get the same Hamiltonian.
Okay. No problem. We discussed that. So, then maybe let me then be precise about it. So, I will just show you how to account and understand all these normalizations. So, field phi on X is expanded into Fourier integral, like this, integral d4k. Exponential I k x phi tilde k. So this is just another this is just an expansion in the Fourier integral, and k x is a Lorentz invariant scalar product. So k mu x mu. Which is also can be written as k0 x0 minus kx. And if you wish, it can be also written as omega t minus kx, where x0 is ct and omega over c is k0. Okay. Now, in the literature, first of all, you can see that people are mainly working in so-called two representations. I give them my name in order to distinguish them. One is called energetic type representation. Energetic type. And it's related to the fact that people, instead of wave definitions of the wave mechanics use de Broglie relations. Energy is related to omega as h bar multiplied by omega, and also momentum is equal to h bar wave vector k. Right? So de Broglie relations. And de Broglie relations allow you to replace
omega with energy and wave vector with momentum. Can you remind me what is the dimension of the wave vector, physical dimension?
1/length.
Exactly. 1/length. So if you take h bar divided by 1/length, you get momentum. And omega? Frequency?
1/time.
Reciprocal to time. Then h bar divided by t is energy. So these are famous de Broglie-Einstein relations. Einstein de Broglie. And then sometimes people start the discussion of the Klein-Gordon field by changing the here the integration measure, and so you will get dE dP 2 pi 3 over 2 C h bar in the power 4 exponential I over h bar energy multiplied by T dx. So this is a de Broglie, essentially de Broglie wave which you see in this exponent. So this is energetic type. And the wave type is the one which I have written. So this would be, say, the first wave type and energetic type, the second type. Then when you plug this representation into the Klein-Gordon equation, so take this and plug into Klein-Gordon. Then for phi tilde, you will obtain the following relation. E over C squared minus P vector squared minus M squared C squared. Now I'm writing everything in terms of standard units. P is equal to zero. So this is the equation which you will obtain. And so this equation must be satisfied, which tells you essentially that phi tilde on P, this Fourier image, must be equal to delta function of P squared minus M squared C squared multiplied by some other function, let's call it phi on P, like this. Can you still see that? Mm-hmm. And the equation written down here is precisely the one which I wrote here. So this is a dispersion relation for a relativistic particle. And in fact, from this relation, you can compute energy. And you see that two signs of energy are allowed. Energy is plus minus square root of P squared C squared plus M squared C. So you can have positive energy solutions and negative energy solutions. So do you know the term dispersion relation?
Mm-hmm.
So what it is, what is the dispersion relation?
It's the relation between wavelength and frequency.
Simpler. Energy of a one particle state, how it depends on the momentum. Dependence of energy on the momentum for one particle. This is a general definition of what you call dispersion. Now, you can use the following trick for the delta function, namely, I'm sure you know this formula, that if you have a delta function depending on the function phi on x, this is a formula for the change of variables of the delta function. So this can be given by sum over O AI. Delta function of x minus ai divided by modulus f prime on ai, like this, where ai's are all the solutions of the equation f on ai is equal to zero.
The formula of change of variables for the delta function. And you can use this formula to write delta function on p squared minus m squared c squared as in the following way: c delta function energy minus c square root p squared plus m squared c squared divided by 2 square root p squared plus m squared c squared plus c delta function e plus c square root p squared plus m squared c squared. This divided by 2 square root p squared plus m squared c squared. After that, you can take this expression, 4 phi tilde, return it back into this formula. And then you can integrate over energy variable. So that means that you can replace one's energy by c square root p squared plus m squared c squared. And in the other term, you can replace energy by minus c square root p squared plus m squared. And after this integration, you will obtain the following formula. You can obtain the following formula. So in terms of this variable phi standing there. So the solution reads as follows: phi on x is c 2 phi c over 2 h bar in the power 4 integral dp divided by 2 energy, and here energy is not anymore an arbitrary variable, it's always p squared plus m squared c squared. De Broglie wave. Phi on dp plus another wave, exponential minus I h bar. Pt minus px phi on minus energy minus p. This in the bracket. And then typically what people do, they introduce the modes a star on p, which is by definition phi dp divided by h cube square root of 2e, and another a on p, which is phi minus e minus p divided by h cube square root of 2e. Okay? These are definitions of complex amplitudes a star and a. And this is just rescaled phi is a vector of energy, and this is at the end of the day the following expression: phi on x is c a bar in the power 1/2 integral dp divided by 2 pi h bar 3 over 2. This is a nice, this is how it's called, the quantum, the element of the quantum volume 2p h bar 3 over 2 in statistical mechanics.
Phase space volume.
1 divided by square root of 2p a star p exponential I h bar energy p minus px like this plus a on p exponential minus I h bar dp minus px. And now this expression is written, I can answer your question about normalization of the oscillators, how they are normalized, and so on and so forth. Yes. So upon quantization, you will obtain the following expression: A on P, A theta on P, right, is given by H bar delta function E minus B prime. Okay, so this is not a relativistically invariant definition. This is not a relativistically invariant definition, but you put the relativistic factor, I will tell you where you put. You put it in the definition of your states in the Hilbert space. So here you put square root of 2 omega on P, and omega, I remind you, it's h bar, omega is the same as my energy, Einstein relation. A dega on P acting on the vacuum. That is, for instance, how your one particle state would look like. With this normalizations and with this description in terms of energetic light variables, the physical dimension of the oscillators of A and A dega, you can easily read off from the right hand side. So dimension of the delta function is 1 over momentum in the power cube. Because if you scale momentum, the delta function, you know this, if you have lambda p, then this behaves as 1 over lambda for one dimensional delta function. And for three dimensional delta function, it will be lambda cube. And so that means that the dimension of this guy is h bar divided by p cube, where p is the momentum, and the same as h bar in the power 1/2 divided by p in the power 0. Now, sometimes people prefer to redefine the operators, creation annihilation operators, to redefine them in such a way. So they introduce sure, I have to distinguish now between different A's. If you have a red pen or maybe this one, black. That is good. Thank you. So let's introduce black operators. Black operators.
Good as a red operator.
Yeah. Black operators, they are given by, in terms of the blue operators, by this formula, A on P, like this, and analogously for A dega. And that leads to the following commutation relation between red operators. So A on P, A dega on P, E prime, equals to twice H bar omega on P delta function on P minus P prime. Ah, this is operator, correct operators. Hopefully, I will not introduce more. But I would like to give an exercise here for you to think. Namely the following exercise. There is no difference. You can work with this normalization and then define your states in this way, or you can, from the very beginning, to work with this normalization. The result, of course, will be the same. The point is that if you work with this normalization, this is sometimes very convenient for scattering theory. If you work with this normalization of the commutation relations and you define your states in this way, then when you compute the norm or overlap of two states, P and Q, you see that this will be given now by 2 H bar omega on P delta P minus P prime. And so you see the return of this normalization in the
overlap between two states P and Q, and then
it should be written in blue.
It should be written in blue, actually. Yes. Now, yes. Confusing.
Yes.
Okay. Here, everything blue. Read as blue. Here, my exercise to students to show that expression on the right hand side here is relativistic invariant. Relativistic invariant. So what does it mean? It means the following, that if you take your momentum P and perform on it a Lorentz transformation, yeah? So P goes to lambda P, then, and Lorentz transformation, what does it mean here? Explicitly in indices, let me write in indices. So you have, generically, you have four momentum. Our first component is an energy. The other three components are special momenta. And so transforming P means that you take Pi, and it goes to Pi tilde lambda I mu P mu, where lambda is a matrix of the Lorentz transformation. So let me denote this for conciseness as P goes to P tilde equals to lambda P. And therefore, the statement is that if you make a Lorentz transformation of P and Q, then the right-hand side will be equals to PQ. In other words, that this expression is relativistic invariant. So now, if you, on the right-hand side, you transform momentum P and P prime according to this rule, the scalar product will not change. We can solve it during the exercise class. Yeah.
From where we get P prime in blue-black line?
Ah, sorry, this is Q. Thank you. I'm continuing to think about this. Q. Now let me put it blue Q. Okay. So this is where relativistic invariance is sitting, and sometimes when you discuss scattering amplitudes, it's important to have relativistic invariance scalar product, which I always prefer to have. Does this answer your question?
No? Of course. Okay. A very detailed explanation. Thank you very much. But I think it was
That was precisely my point, because this is so vast subject. I mean, I can go in the direction you drive me, actually. Yes, you can drive me in certain directions. Good. Now I can talk about how much time do I have? 30 minutes is good. So maybe I can tell you how to quantize electromagnetic field first, because it's not so. Like half an hour. Electromagnetic field, and maybe then tomorrow I will briefly pass through the Dirac field, and then we come to the scattering theory. But today I maybe explain you some not so known obvious things about quantization of the electromagnetic field, which is of course a very well studied subject, classical subject. But since we are biases, we should
of course
yes, we should keep to the earth. Good. So there are two basic ways to perform quantization of electromagnetic field. So now I'm talking about Maxwell theory. I hope everyone knows that classical Maxwell theory is described by Maxwell equations for electric and magnetic fields. In the vacuum, these equations are so important that I will write.
In fact, Gleb, it's very good to go to this point because there are so many messes in many textbooks about
quantization
of electromagnetic fields. So,
yes, yes. You're right. Yeah. Sure. Absolutely. Yeah, good. Okay, so
I will put Maxwell equations in red. So divergence of H is equal to zero, and then dH over dt is equal to minus C curl of E. Divergence of E is equal to zero. So I will discuss Maxwell equations in the vacuum. So there are no sources for me for the moment. And that's why divergence of E for me is equal to zero. And here I have curl of H. These are Maxwell equations. And in order to make sense of these equations, they must involve one constant C with a dimension of velocity. You can think about all the dimensions to make them right. Yeah, it's actually easy to see. E and H have the same dimension, and when you put C to the right-hand side, you get dH over dL, and so L is reproduces the dimension of the curl. So you need this C in order to make equations to be consistent. And C experimentally appears to coincide with the speed of light. And we like these equations very much because if people would think about them very carefully, about the group invariance of these equations, then they would immediately come to special relativity. These equations would immediately tell you that there is a special relativity around. Yeah. But it made so much effort to come to this. Yeah.
You know, if Alexei Simikhatov would be here, unfortunately, he left. He would tell us that, you know, that economical effect from this Maxwell equations covered all expenses for scientists for their, I don't know, for all years, 100 years.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. Yeah. If you take them very seriously and you just pose a mathematical question, what is the most general transformation group of these equations, which leaves equations in line? You will discover special relativity. That's why we like this equation. They are fundamental. This is relativity, which you see, which is around you, light. Light. And you see it's here.
Yeah.
It's in front of you. Good. That's why we like them. Well, they describe electromagnetic waves in quantum field theory. They describe photons. The term photon has been coined by chemist Gilbert Lewis, 1926. The word photon has been invented. Lewis. Chemists. I don't know why chemists invented such a word, but this is now the very economic convenient way to describe electromagnetic field is to start to introduce the object which is called potential, A mu, so electromagnetic potential. Electromagnetic potential. And then in terms of this electromagnetic potential, we construct the tensor F mu, which is by definition this quantity here. And then you can verify or you can relate F mu directly with the observable electric and magnetic fields. So F mu relates components of F mu are related to E and B. Now, electromagnetic potential is a not observable quantity because you can change it. It admits a change by so-called
gradient transformation. You can change potential by derivative of any function alpha, and the electromagnetic tensor F mu nu will not see this change because then you will get d mu d nu alpha minus d nu d mu alpha equals to zero. And so it produced no effect, change of the potential produced no effect on the observable quantities E and H. So I'm writing E and H. Good. And we can derive Maxwell equations starting from the following action. So maybe now I'll write it here still because this is all known, and all known goes in red here. Very well known. So this is minus 1 over 4 C. Integral e for x f mu nu f mu nu. I hope you know this very well. Okay. And then from here you can get Maxwell equations in the vacuum d mu f mu nu equals zero. All equations are comprised by this one equation here.
Not all the equations.
No, there is also a Bianchi identity. So why we like electromagnetic potential? So typically this is called the first pair of the Maxwell equations, and this is called the second pair of Maxwell equations. And when you introduce electromagnetic potential and related to the fields E and D by the Pauling formula. So E is minus gradient of A0, minus gradient of A0, minus 1 over C dA over dt. And H is a curl of A. So components of A being equal A0 and A vector are called scalar and vector potential. So scalar potential, and the vector potential. And so this is explicit writing of this equation here. And if you have such a relationship between E and H, then the first pair of Maxwell equations is automatically satisfied. You solve it. And then the second pair of Maxwell equations actually gives you dynamical equations. Dynamical equations for A mu. Now, the two ways to quantize. Because of this invariance, which is a local or gauge invariance, the system has unphysical degrees of freedom. And as it was extensively discussed yesterday, the actual degrees of freedom of a photon are two transverse polarizations. Well, originally, you start here from four components of the vector potential. So originally, you have four components. But physically, you know that there are only two polarizations. Okay, let me write them. AI, I is equal 1 and 2, and two transverse. And one way to get rid of unphysical degrees of freedom is to fix a gauge, namely to subject your potential to some condition. Very often, what is done in order to describe physical degrees of freedom, people impose the so-called Coulomb gauge, which is the same as divergence of A is equal to zero. Divergence of the vector potential is equal to zero. This is a Coulomb gauge. And then you can perform quantization of your theory. Coulomb. Then you can perform a quantization of your theory in the Coulomb gauge. So you can write down the Hamiltonian formalism, define the Hamiltonian, quantize it according to the canonical prescription, and obtain quantum connector. But the problem with this is that this gauge choice breaks manifest Lorentz invariance. So Lorentz invariance is broken. So drawbacks here are, first, Lorentz invariance is broken. And so that means that when you construct your quantum theory, you have to worry that there is no quantum, there is no anomaly in the Lorentz transformation. So you have to guarantee somehow, you have to check a posteriori that you are not breaking the Lorentz invariance, which is fundamental principle, because you would like to be able to understand your theory in any Lorentz frame, in any inertial frame. So it's better that Lorentz invariance is preserved. And second drawback is that, especially if you take into account sources and you perform a quantization in the Coulomb gauge, then the action appears to be non-local. Action is non-local. And it's rather difficult to deal with non-local actions. You can still proceed with a Coulomb gauge quantization. This is something which is developed in the literature. But of course, you should keep in mind these problems.
What do we mean by we say non-local action?
Okay, I can write for you the Hamiltonian which you obtain in the Coulomb gauge. So the Hamiltonian in the Coulomb gauge is the following. It looks as follows. 1 over 2 integral dx, transverse component of the electric field squared plus magnetic field squared. So this is more or less is okay. But then if you include an interaction with a taking into account the possibility of a source, if you would introduce a source J, then here you will get J0 on X, J on Y, J0 on Y. J0 is a zero component of a source. So this is a source current, and J0 is a zero component divided by X minus Y. This is a Hamiltonian of electrodynamics in the Coulomb gauge. So in the Coulomb gauge, you can check, you can see that when you impose the Coulomb gauge, the potential A0 appears to be zero. So there is no scalar potential. But removing the scalar potential is not so innocent, because for two static charges, interaction is due to the scalar potential. And this, in fact, hits you back in the reappearance of this non-local term here. It's a Coulomb potential between two sources. So it hits you back, it appears when you try to quantize the zero in the Coulomb gauge and then in zero. Now, you solve it, A0 is equal to zero when you have on the right hand side zero, but it becomes a classical object which is solved in terms of currents, solved in terms of zero, and this leads to the appearance of this term in the Hamiltonian. And this term I call non-local, because you see it's, it depends on the value of the source
point. May I make a comment on this point? I've recently learned by chance that this Coulomb gauge is very widely used in quantum chemistry, where calculations of molecules is done because they do not need Lorentz invariance, first of all. And second, exactly this property that A0 is the...
Not dynamical, but solid.
Yes, yes. It's very, very useful for Hartree-Fock calculations. So they calculate the levels in the Hartree-Fock approximation, and then this A0 can be taken as a classical potential in which you find the energy levels. And then if you consider the transitions, you have to take into account only the transversal photons. So you do not need to.
So it's like a classical background which is completely solved.
So the background is taken into account non-perturbative, so to say.
Yeah.
So
okay.
That's why it's very widely used. I've learned it recently, and really it's very useful.
Yeah, that's very interesting. Yes. Yeah, so this is basically a story. I can, of course, describe how you can get this Hamiltonian, but I prefer maybe not to go here into details because I would like to talk about covariant quantization. But this is something to have in mind. This is the one root of one times. Now, covariant quantization. Covariant quantization is an approach which attempts to overcome this difficulty in breaking the Lorentz invariance. So this is what I'm going to discuss now. I'm not sure, I have 15 minutes left, but I think if I will not finish, I will continue naturally.
Yes.
Yeah, during the next lecture.
Yes.
It's okay. That's a bit interesting story because, you know. Maybe I will make one remark before I go to this quantization about what we have discussed about stress energy tensor being symmetric versus non-symmetric and what happens for electromagnetic field in this case. So let me tell you what happens for electromagnetic field and why you don't have a spin for a photon. If you apply Noether theorem to electromagnetic field, so this is your action. Action is written down here. It's invariant, manifested with respect to Lorentz transformations. Therefore, there must be conserved currents. In particular, there should be a current corresponding to rotations, three-dimensional rotations. And then you go to the Noether theorem and just straightforwardly apply Noether theorem. You obtain a current, J, mu, which corresponds to rotations, three-dimensional rotations. So I'm not considering now the full Lorentz group. I'm just restricting myself to three-dimensional rotations. And correspondingly, you define the conserved charge, as we discussed yesterday, by taking the zeros component and integrating it for one x special directions, special directions. And in the case of a photon, Gij, this charge computed according to Noether theorem takes the following form: a k dot xi dj minus xj ki ak like this minus ai aj dot minus aj dot ai bracket is closed. So this is a sum of two quantities. The first quantity is given by this expression here, and this is what we should naturally identify according to our discussion of yesterday. We are with an orbital path for the stress tensor. So this will be orbital path, and I denote it by Lij. I mean, the whole integral here is 1 over c squared. I will identify this Lij. And what is left over here, I will identify with a spin form, Sij. And once again, why it's an orbital path, you can construct it via canonical stress tensor, precisely as I explained yesterday. And then the rest is Sij. And so Jij is the sum of these two. Now, it's extremely simple to verify
that both of them, Lij and Sij, are conserved. They're both conserved. And this is, of course, related to the fact that for electromagnetic field, you can always choose your stress energy tensor to be symmetric. Either you improve it or you use gravity to that. So it can always be made symmetric. And that's why orbital part and the spin part are separately conserved. If you wish, I can immediately check it for you for the spin part. So you take ds over dt. It's proportional to integral ai double dot dot aj plus ai dot aj dot minus aj double dot ai minus aj dot ai dot. Then you see that these terms dot cancel, right? And I can, for instance, this expression is worked out in the Coulomb gauge, where A0 is equal to 0. Then Maxwell equations boil down to just a statement that box of A I is equal to 0. And here, that means that I can replace double dots by simply second derivative of xi squared, epsilon ai. And here, this double dots will be replaced through this equation in other words, on shell, because we are checking conservation only on shell of AG. Then we integrate by parts once, and then we get zero. Because what we get is expression gradient of AI, gradient of AG, minus gradient of AG. Gradient of AI. This is always easy. Okay. So again, this all there is nothing special here. It's all enacted with standard considerations. And at first, you think that this is your orbital momentum and this is your spin. Now there appears the following. If, first of all, Jij is total angular momentum. And that means that if you compute the Poisson bracket of its components, you will find the standard expression for the Poisson algebra of angular momentum. And this is indeed true. This is what you will find. Well, minus is not so important. It's an algebra of angular momentum. Everyone knows this algebra?
Maybe come here. Because I realized yesterday sitting over there that it's not so good to write very
near the boundary of the black box.
Near the low boundary of the black box.
So what I'm saying is that this is what you must have. And since Lij and Sij, if you want to treat them as an angular momentum, as an orbital momentum, orbital, and spin, they must have the same algebras. Instead, if you do an explicit computation, what you find is the following result. So epsilon, you probably you worry about my definition here. Yes, you worry about this, and you do it rightly, because I forgot to mention that I introduced gi by definition as 1 half epsilon ijk jjk. So now I use epsilon tensor. And write down, this is my definition, 1 half epsilon ijk, jj. Yeah? This is quantities with one index, duals of a tensor jjk. And these quantities must satisfy the algebra of the angular momentum. Absolutely in analogous way, you introduce Li and Si. Li and Si.
absolutely the same. 1 half epsilon Lij, 1 half epsilon Si.
And instead of what you expect, you find the following algebra. Li Lj is equal to epsilon ijk minus Lk plus Sk. This is very good training for you to make this computation. And even that is nice. Si Sj is equal to zero. This is what you find when you do actual computation. First of all, L and S do not commute with respect to the bracket. S's commute between themselves, and L's do not give you the expected angular momentum algebra. But if you take the sum, L plus S, like that, then the angular momentum algebra is reproduced. So separately orbital path and spin path fail to separately satisfy this relation, in spite of the fact that they are conserved separately, but they fail to reproduce what you would expect normally from angular momentum and from the speed. In fact, this variable S corresponds to helicity. And if you compute it in terms of oscillators, you clearly see what you find is a helicity vector. And when you quantize it, it becomes a helicity operator in the quantum theory. You can construct it explicitly in terms of creation annihilation operators. Helicity, good. Then probably I will postpone quantization of electromagnetic field because it's a nice discussion and I don't want to make mess of it. I would like to postpone it for the next time. And in the remaining 5 minutes, maybe I can answer your questions if you have them here. So please ask me.
Coming back to you describing the procedure of first quantization and second quantization. So could you explain in more detail what's the first quantization? You said it's just coming from classical fields to Klein-Gödel fields, but to my understanding, classical is Klein-Gödel, so kind of contradiction.
Yeah, it depends how you look at it, because you see, what you do in the case of quantum mechanics, you start really from the classical theory. You describe a classical phase space. You describe a measure in this classical phase space, for instance, Liouville measure. You find a classical Hamiltonian, and you build up an evolution of your system. And then you say, oh, I do now the quantization. And this is the first quantization. Now I define my Hilbert space, and I define a quantization map to any observable in the classical phase space. I put in correspondence operator, and then to a classical state on the phase space, I put in correspondence a wave function. So wave function corresponds to a state on the classical phase space. Right? And this is the first quantization. So really, really from the classical theory. And what are your classical equations of motion is described precisely by this equation I wrote here. This is your classical equation of motion. In the quantum theory, this equation becomes, you should know this, quantum analog of this equation is called Schrödinger. No, Schrödinger equation is an equation for the Heisenberg equation, yes. So it becomes a Heisenberg equation for the dynamical variable I over H bar, commutator of the quantum Hamiltonian H, this F. And in a way, this procedure from classical phase space, to a Hilbert space, where psi is a vector, wave function is a vector, which corresponds here to a state. It's called, understood as in Dirac terms, as a first quantization. The point that the classical, you think about classical
Klein-Gordon equation as a classical equation, it's not a problem because you can think about a Schrödinger equation also coming from some variational principle. You can write down Lagrangian, and you can derive Schrödinger equation also from variational principle. You understand what I mean? Not quite. I mean that Schrödinger equation can be interpreted as an equation of motion for some Lagrangian. In other words, as something which delivers a stationary point of some functional. So I have an example somewhere. Let me maybe write it down. If you consider such first order action of the first order here, first order in time, psi star dt psi, and if you vary this equation with respect to psi, my statement is that what you obtain for psi is precisely the Schrödinger equation. So in order to get a familiar form of the Schrödinger of the Hamiltonian, what you have to take for h for the Hamiltonian, I think this is an expression, h bar over 2m dx di psi star di psi. This would correspond to standard second derivative of psi in the Schrödinger equation plus 1 over 2h bar squared integral dx dy. And this quartic term here will be responsible for the potential, for non-trivial potential if you have one. Xy psi star on x, psi star on y. Psi.
This is perfect. Your nuclear physics is there.
Yes.
That is what you mentioned.
Yeah. So basically, what I want to say that if you are in the framework of the standard quantum mechanics, if you do standard quantum mechanics, then for quantum mechanics can also be described in the language of second quantization. There is no problem to do that. But for quantum mechanics, it does not bring anything new, because the difference between quantum field theory and the quantum mechanics is that, in general, in quantum field theory, the number of particles is not conserved. In quantum mechanics, the number of particles is always conserved. You describe your system always with a wave function which depends on n coordinates, psi, x1, and so on, xn. This is your starting point. You are solving Schrödinger equation for the wave function which depends on n coordinates. Each coordinate you can think about to be associated to a particle. So number of particles is always conserved. In quantum field theory, we know that is not the case. the number of operator does not commute with the Hamiltonian because of non-trivial interaction terms. And therefore, the real advantage of the Fock space for quantum field theory is that the Fock space accommodates states which correspond to different particle number. And the interactions, particularly Hamiltonian, allow you to mix the states with different, which are eigenstates of number operators. Because number operators simply, in quantum mechanics, commutes with the Hamiltonian, so n with h in mechanics, quantum mechanics commute with the Hamiltonian. In field theory, this is not the case. And this is another big difference between quantum and classical mechanics. As soon as you introduce interactions, forget about conservation of the particle number. Right? And the Fock space, which we were talking about, allows you to accommodate very nicely states with different particle numbers. So one particle state was proportional to AP1 acting on a vacuum dagger. Then you can build up two particle states, two-way daggers, and so on. And so in a way, quantum field theory, if you wish, it's an infinite collection of quantum mechanics which are interacting with each other. The states talk to each other in quantum field theory. Does this answer your question? So if you think about Klein-Gordon field as a wave function, there is no problem that it can be obtained equation for it, like a Schrödinger equation I was writing, which is a Klein-Gordon equation. If you wish, if you can obtain, you can think about this as coming from some variational principle, from some Lagrange. Just you can do the same for the normal quantum mechanics. People in optics, for instance, study the so-called nonlinear Schrödinger equations. They like it very much. It's not so much relevant to quantum mechanics, but in optics, yeah.
Nonlinear, non-local.
Non-linear. There was a question.
I just wanted to make a short comment to your explanation. You see, I know that Fock space is widely used in nuclear physics.
Mm-hmm.
In various nuclear models, for example, the so-called Elliott model for light nuclei, where the three-dimensional oscillator is used as a zero-order approximation. And then you work in terms of number of quanta for each degree of freedom. So it's used really in nuclear physics. So what you said is it's very convenient if you have
convenient framework.
Yes, exactly. And if you consider only energy level, then you have, of course, a fixed number of quanta. But if you consider transitions from various levels, then you pass from one state with one number of quanta to a state with a different number of quanta. But it's very widely used in nuclear model.
Thank you. So if there is an interest, I can explain this, for instance, during the exercise session, how you rewrite quantum mechanics as a second quantized theory. No problem, I can show you how it's exactly goes.
We
will see. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, let's thank thanks a lot. So we are a bit out of time, but still 15 minutes for coffee break, and we will start Christopher, 10 minutes later, but we will have time in the end.